So my name is Jay Shepherd. I graduated from Paragould High School in 2003, and I came to Arkansas State to study classical guitar. And I graduated later and got my master's degree here as well. And I've been teaching here off and on since I got my master's, all but maybe a few years. Some of the years I'm just playing music and not teaching at all, but it's good to be back at Arkansas State again this year. classical guitar to me is an instrument, but it's also two other things. The classical guitar, in addition to being an instrument with, you know, nylon strings and traditional, as everyone understands it, is also a technique of playing the guitar, that you would play this type of guitar with your fingers and the left hand technique that you would perform. But also, classical guitar suggests a repertoire of music that, as a classical guitarist, you're kind of expected to keep up. And it's not necessary that you have to like all the music that you play. It happens in every genre of music. Not everyone is so lucky to be able to play the music that they love to play the most all the time. When you play music professionally, sometimes you have to learn things that you're not as excited about, and you have to really dig deep to find reasons and meanings in those pieces of music, and motivation to make you want to practice those and bring them to life. You know, you have to learn to get excited about pieces of music that you may not be excited about at first. But what I find is the more that you work on those things, the more you get attached to them, and the more they do mean to you, the more work you put in them. And that's the most challenging thing, is finding ways to get excited about interpreting pieces of music that that you've heard everybody else play, maybe, but you're trying to find the way that you're going to play it, what makes most sense to you as a performer. I interpret music has a lot to do with the kind of music I've listened to, and sometimes it makes my interpretation sounds awful to other people, and sometimes there's people that really like the way I interpret music, and I think a lot of those people that like that have been through the same kind of life and growing up that I went through. For instance, you know, a big part of my life before I played guitar was video games. And so I'm 35, so the video games that were out when I was a kid were like on an 8-bit system, the NES, and then the 16-bit SNES. And that was the 80 or 90% of the games I played when I was a kid. So when I think about the sound engines for those games and how very simple they were and that they didn't have much to work with, one of the things about an 8-bit system and making music, see, if you only have so many voices, you have to play with those different voices. Maybe you have 3 or 4 voices. So to make the most out of music, those voices have to move in what you call counterpoint, typically, to where instead of playing like a chord and then there's a melody above that chord, those 4 voices have to move in tandem with each other together to do as much work. Like they all play a melody, but at the same time, you hear the chord as they move along together. It's a very sophisticated way of writing music. And when I play music, the classical guitar repertoire that has a lot of that in there, like Bach, lots of counterpoint, like a Bach fugue. I make interpretive decisions, I think, about music that are influenced by a lot of music that I've heard that's that same texture. So, you know, sometimes when I hear, like, I go back and play some of these games I played when I was a kid, like Dragon Warrior series, you know, I hear a lot of that counterpoint in there because a lot of the music kind of Baroque, old, you know, sounding to kind of get that kind of Dungeons and Dragons, castles and kings and queens and princesses kind of stuff going on. And so when I remember that music and I kind of find myself, you know, seeing a lot of classical music through the eyes of people that are imitating that music, with the music that I grew up with in 8-bit. Because honestly, the majority of the music I grew up when I was a young kid was in video games. And I think a lot of the way I interpret music and even write music, a lot of that source material, you know, that I have deep inside my mind are from those 8-bit, 16-bit video games I grew up playing as a child. They're like little loops and soundtracks of my life deep in that. And then the more I've become aware of that, you know, in my life, I at some point I tried to fight it. And then I just gave up and said, man, that's who I am. And I just kind of let it blossom. I'm just kind of like, well. And what's funny is, you know, when I release music like that, nobody ever calls me on it. Oh, that sounds like 8-bit, 16-bit video game. Like, man, that sounds like, I've never heard anything like that. Because a lot of people haven't, because they didn't grow up then. So it's been this really unique perspective, you know, being a Nintendo addict to guitar addict. You know, that's what happens. Thing about music in my experience, so you can think about music in 3 tenses, and you can use that information to affect your performance in the now. So, you know, you can think about things that have happened in the music in the past that you've already played, that have already happened, and you can relate that to what's happening right now and how those things maybe come back in the future of the music. And by projecting and using that information in kind of a feedback loop, you can interpret the music in such a way that you're able to influence it from 3 positions in time. And I find that's the most interesting thing about music is, as a listener, you only experience the music in the now, during the first listen. But when you listen again, you remember things that you heard the last time that you hear again in a different way. So there's that whole re-listen aspect of music that, as a performer, I think we get to enjoy more than just, you know, listeners of music. We get to experience all three tenses of music and work with that material in a way that it interprets the music in the now and the way we perform it. You know, I don't think the problems we have in music are the industry. I think we have to do a better job as a society of educating young people about music, in particular instrumental music and playing instruments. I think that the sophistication and nuance that a human gets out of a touch, their own physical touch in mind playing a real musical instrument, that level of complexity and color is becoming increasingly void from recorded music, especially. And I think you can't duplicate that level of sophistication. And I think the in and out that the recording industry has now with recording an album, people want to get in and out quick because you can't make as much money anymore from recorded music. So therefore, it puts more of a strain on engineers and session players to hurry up and record that album in as few takes as possible. And it leads to a less sophisticated music because it allows the computer essentially to do more work, as expecting the humans themselves to play better until it just sounds perfectly and uniquely good as it can sound. So the one thing I would change about the industry would be find some way to get people paying for recorded music again. So some of these legacy studios could bring back some of their legacy producers and legacy work ethic that they demand of artists and bands to create incredible sounding albums, as opposed to them being only existent in home produced albums now, where that's the very few spots that you find really worked on, labored on music is in indie records that people do themselves. And it's a shame because they're hard to find, whereas in old legacy media, when Warner Brothers or put out a record, everybody could find it because they played it on the radio, and you go down to Walmart or wherever and you would find it on the shelf and you would buy it and you would unwrap it, pay your $15 for it and put it in your car, and it would sound great because it had the same legacy of people working on those studios and that music for decades, and it sounded great. So that's the one thing I would change. You got to find a way to get people to pay for recorded music again so we can get more talent and time and effort into recorded music and popular music again. Thank you. of all the genres of music I play, classical guitar is probably my best, just because I put more time in it, you know, and energy. But my biggest influences, I think, are actually rock and roll musicians. Just because they were so influential in my early development. So like Hendrix, and you know, secondarily, I think, as far as electric guitar, Eddie Van Halen. Because, you know, when I think about the history of electric guitar and rock and roll music, which has really inspired me to play the guitar, I can really see it in three periods. There's before Jimi Hendrix, after Jimi Hendrix, and then after Eddie Van Halen. And, you know, and recently Eddie Van Halen just passed away a few weeks ago, and it was really sad. I think it bummed me out for a couple weeks. It's like, you know, watching a member of your family die, you know. That guy gave me so much inspiration and influence in the way I play guitar. I mean, it even affects the way I play a classical guitar. When I look at my technique compared to, like, other players who maybe aren't American, you know, because I think rock and roll and electric guitar, especially players like Hendrix and Van Halen, are really kind of an American commodity. And so, you know, when I see myself play guitar compared to, like, I see, like, a lot of Russian players that don't really know American popular music very much. But on the other hand, I see French players like Thomas Viateau, Jeremy Jouve, that they play, and their technique looks a lot like mine. And sure enough, when you ask them about electric guitar, the French players know exactly what you're talking about, because they all play electric guitar too, and they love the American, you know, figureheads of the genre. Whereas, you know, the Russian players are like, Jimmy who? You know, Eddie Van what? Like, they have no idea who that is. You know, they think they're probably some kind of, like, obscure 1930s Dutch jazz musician or something. So, it's interesting. They just don't know. Thank you. best descriptor I could give of music right now is it's just communication. It's just a different way of language. It's a different way to communicate what it is to be human, what it is to be a human in a society, whether it's your town or part of the country or your view of the world. Even it's an expressive tool to communicate with other people. Thank you. you just have to love music. You just have to love the what music does to you. Because it's life's not easy, you know, no matter what you do. No matter if you're nailing boards on a roof, and you know, or driving a FedEx truck, or making coffee, I've done those things. But at the end of the day, no matter how bad you feel, or at the beginning of the day, you have to look forward to getting up and playing music. And if you don't, you hope that when you turn on the radio, it makes you excited about listening to music. And so far, luckily, those things have done it for me, and it kept me wanting to play music. So that's what it takes, is you have to like music. You have to love it.